microtones here.
I could just go forever and ever and ever. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison, Guitar Interactive, GI Plus. My Mac is over here in case you're wondering why I'm leaning and staring. It's Monday evening. We're doing the thing that we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar today. As you may have noticed, we're down at the studio, and that always comes with a litany of technical challenges that James is bravely solving as we go on, not least of which is the fact that we've been experimenting with some new streaming setups. Now, we're not quite ready to pull the trigger on this yet, but we've been experimenting with some new stuff to improve the audio quality, the video quality of these streams. You will get to hear that in the next few weeks, I think, because we're committed to keep bringing you guys better and better content. So we've been experimenting with that, but part of that means that there are some, let's say some teething problems when it comes to getting the levels just right for the regular streams. It's one of those things. We don't have two setups that we can A-B between. We're just kind of pulling stuff out of one and putting it back in and seeing how it works out. But we think we've got some cool stuff coming for you. A little bit of housekeeping, first of all, if you're a first-time viewer. Hey, thanks for joining us. It's Monday. We do thing on Mondays. We hang out and we talk about the guitar. And this last few weeks, I mean, I guess the last couple of months now, we've been talking about the blues. We've made a transition from discussing arpeggios and the like through to discussing primarily blues-based topics, and it's been leading up to something, an exciting announcement that I have for you for next week's stream. I'll tell you about that in a second, but if you are a first-time viewer, a couple of things that you can do if you enjoy what we're doing here to help us kind of spread the message of what we're doing and reach as many guitar players as we can. You can use the like button, as was suggested by, who said it? Someone here said, let's use the like button. I can't remember. I'll find it when I take a look at the comments. But yes, absolutely, use the like button. The like button is your friend. It helps us out a whole lot. So drop us a like on whatever platform you're watching on. If you're watching on YouTube, consider giving us a subscribe. We love your subscription. It does help us reach as many guitar players as possible and also helps us metaphorically keep the lights on and also continually bring you updates and upgrades to our streaming quality that we're working hard on. So other things you can do is if you really want to help us out, the thing that helps us keep bringing these streams to you the most is if you go to this URL down here. See this URL? That is guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-podcast.
plus. That is the word P-L-U-S, not the plus symbol. Now, what that's going to take you to is a site called GI Plus, which is the premium subscription service from Guitar Interactive magazine, where we offer lessons from the likes of myself, Andy Wood, Andy James, Rick Graham, Tom Quayle, Sam Bell, Giorgio Cerchi, Michael Caswell, Lewis Turner, you name it, I'm on there too. We've got a whole bunch of great courses that I think you're going to enjoy. I'll show you a couple of them as the evening goes on. Also, don't forget, you can drop us a comment. We love your comments. The algorithm in particular loves your comments. I've thrown my pick away. I shall grab another. The algorithm in particular loves your comments. So if you've got comments, down below. But more importantly, if you have questions, we'd love to hear from you too. Now, we're going to turn our attention to the comment section. Let's see how everyone's getting on. I'm going to say some hellos. When we are done saying hello to everybody, I have a really exciting announcement for next week's stream. And when I say exciting, I mean exciting. So we'll talk about that in a second. But first, let's check in with our regular streamers and see who is in the house. Marcin was not the person at all. It was Sacred Godslayer. Says, hi Nick, hi guys. I'm squinting at a tiny screen here, by the way. Sacred Godslayer, great to have you on board, our Italian heavy metal correspondent. Marcin is in the house. Marcin, great to see you. I'm intrigued by this stream title. You should be, my man, because microtones, interesting topic. I was, funnily enough, I was taught music when I was a young man, aged 16, let's say, might have been a little older, by my course leader was a guy called Martin McAloon. He was the bass player from Prefab Sprout, of all things. His brother Paddy was kind of the main man. Didn't like each other very much, apparently, but that's a different story. And Martin McAloon discovered that his name is an anagram of microtonal man, and then proceeded to teach us about microtones for 2 years, regardless of what was on the syllabus. Let me tell you, it wasn't microtones. But I did come away with a bit more of an understanding of the blues, so that's cool. Who else do we have? PJ is here. PJ, great to see you. How can we share our efforts with you, Nick, and with each other? Well, a few ways you can do this. So, best way to share it with me is on Instagram. So if you find me on Instagram, at Nick Jennison, send me a message or tag me in a post if you're playing. I love to see him. Always love to see him. Other ways you can do it is you can upload your playing to the Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, which is our Facebook group. If you go onto Facebook and search Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, you'll find us there. Post your playing in there. I'll get to see it and everybody else will get to see it too. If you share it with me, you know, and you want me to and you're into that sort of thing, I'll share it on the stream. I'll play it on the stream. We've done some of that stuff before. We'd love to see it. Timothy Appling is in the house. Timothy, great to see you. Foghornish is here. David Yates says here, evening guys, finally had an EMG test on my arms. I thought you meant active pickups there for a second, but electromyograph, I think it is, I'm not sure. EMG test on my arms. I've not got carpal tunnel syndrome, however, the ulnar nerve on both my arms are entrapped. Now I've got to wait for a scan on my neck / spine. Ouch, that sounds painful, man. I'm sorry you're still having trouble with this. I'm sorry to hear that. I guess there is, carpal tunnel is pretty serious business. It's kind of a chronic thing, whereas I think these trapped nerves, they're less so. I'm not a doctor, and I'm certainly not your doctor, so take my advice with a huge pinch of guitar player shaped salt. But I think that probably sounds less serious, but I don't know. Hopefully it is. Hopefully you'll get remedy very, very soon. I mean, these are the mistakes we make when we start to early diagnose stuff, I guess. We point our finger at the common suspects, like, oh, it must be carpal tunnel. Shows it could be something else, I guess. So it might be caused by my neck / spine, or it could be something else. Hopefully I won't have to wait as long for the scan as I did for this test. Well, hopefully you'll get sorted very soon, man, because I know you've been suffering. So, you know, lots of things you can do to remedy your playing. Remember, scale the amount of playing that you're doing, scale the intensity of the playing, make the playing easier, make the guitar easier to play, all of those things, find an entry point and work up from there. We'll talk more about that in a bit, but again, medical advice I'm not qualified to give. Blues advice, yes, but medical advice, not so much. So let's see who else we have in the stream. We've got some real good stuff here, some interesting medical stories going on. We'll touch on those a bit later. Thank you for sharing those, by the way, you guys in the comments. Do appreciate you taking the time to share all that stuff. And I'm very sorry to hear about your medical issues, as is Kim. Oh, there we go. Kim's in the chat. Hi, Kim. How you doing? Kim is not in the London studio today. Kim is somewhere very sunny. Although it's very sunny here. So, you know, who knows? Maybe it's raining where Kim is. Maybe we've got the sunshine. Says, hi, Nick. Evening, everyone. Sorry to hear about your various health issues. I'm not going to get into this about the National Health Service. It will turn into an angry rant. Well, let's not get into that. Let's absolutely not get into that. Let's see what else we have in the house. Keith M.O.F. Hi, Nick, fellow guitarist. Keith M.O.F., it's great to see you. Steve McD is in the house. Who else do we have? Cowcat is here. About health issues in guitar, it could be an interesting lesson about posture while playing, or basically how to not screw up your body while trying to play. I would rather defer you to some good medical professionals for that rather than give medical advice myself. What I will say is that much is made of posture and what is good posture and what is bad posture. The current evidence on the subject suggests that there is no such thing as good or bad posture, and your best posture is your next posture. And it's my understanding that the majority of injuries are a stress dose issue. So it's not a bad thing to hunch over, for example. It's not a bad thing to stand up straight. If you do one of them too much, it'll likely cause you some bother. How much is too much? Depends on your individual tolerance. Tissues adapt, all that sort of thing. I'm a big fan of barbell medicine for this sort of stuff. So if you guys are interested in that, I would urge you to Google barbell medicine. They have some really great content on this. Another really great researcher on this is Greg Lehman, who's very into this sort of thing. Who else? I'll think of some more and I'll shoot you that way. Most of this comes from my lifting journey. But again, very sorry to hear about your stuff, your health issues, man. I really appreciate it. You taking the time to share that with us, though, because, you know, it's good to see the journey is progressing and that you're getting at least a little bit of help. Timothy Appling says, Nick's doing a webinar for Lick Library tomorrow for those who are interested. I am indeed. It's going to be on the subject of moving beyond power chords. We haven't done a chord stream in ages. So we're doing one Lick Library at 7 o'clock tomorrow night on the Lick Library YouTube channel. Cracker Tom is in the house. Greets from sunny Germany. Also impressed by all the health issues. All the best then. Let's enjoy the lesson for sure, man. Hopefully there'll be some stuff that we can take from this. Also, this stuff works really well with slide. So if the hands are still giving you some grief, maybe slide is the thing, you know? I said this to a friend of mine who, she recently hurt her back. And the way we framed it, she's powerlifter. The way we framed it was, okay, it really sucks that you've hurt your back. Your back is going to get better. But in the meantime, when you can't squat and you can't deadlift, it's time to PR your bench press. So, you know, makes sense. We can devote our training to other things. And similarly, you know, if you're having difficulty with your fretting hand in particular, maybe it's time to take up slide. You know, maybe that's the thing. We've talked about this before, though, man, at some length. Chris Brown is here, and I'm talking about sharing content. Chris Brown regularly shares his playing with us. We love to see it. Love to see that sort of stuff. Keenan Page is here. It's been a while, man. Thanks for coming back. It's good to see you. Phil Jones says, hello, been lurking for a few weeks now. Some great stuff here. Phil, thanks for taking the time to comment. We're really glad that you came back. Appreciate you being here. Who else do we have? Tommy from Ireland is here. Who else do we have? Let's just very quickly rattle through this. Duke with a load of numbers, 49, 49, 49, from Missouri, USA. Good to see you, man. Thanks for joining us. My knees hurt. My knees hurt too. I had a really bad hand health issue when I started playing. Change of diet and lifestyle has helped a lot, but it may not help everybody. It is a thing, to be fair. Diet, lifestyle, and getting enough physical activity do help too. So anyway, I got to remind you on this, I am not a doctor, and I am most definitely not your doctor. So please take my advice with a huge grain of salt. Go and watch Barbell Medicine. They actually are doctors. So anyway, promised you guys an exciting announcement. So exciting announcement is going to be. Next week marks the first in what's hopefully going to be a semi-regular line of guest streams. Now, if you've wondered why we've been talking about Clever Blues for the last few weeks, it's been in the lead up to next week's stream. And I'm going to invite you guys to do what we normally do on this, which is come on board, ask questions, you know, have your questions answered. But instead of being answered by me, we're going to have your questions answered by our guest next week. I'll still be there too. I'll be playing as well, and I'll be, you know, chatting about this stuff. But our guest next week, playing some Clever Blues and talking about his playing and his career and his guitar and all that sort of stuff, none other than Josh Smith. Right? That Josh Smith. Joe Bonamassa's guitar player, blues extraordinaire, player of unfeasibly large strings. Josh Smith is joining us next week for our stream. That is the big exciting announcement that I had for you. Told you it was exciting. I didn't want to like over egg the pudding, but the reason we've been doing so much blues stuff is because Josh is going to be with us talking about the blues next week. So that is going to be really, really cool. I'm super excited for it. So make sure you're there for that next week. Anyway, in the meantime, let's get into the meat of today's stream. Well, don't forget, by the way, the The floor is still open for you guys to ask questions all the way through this stream. So ask away. You got any questions at all, you let me know and I'll try my best to answer them. Same goes for next week, big time. So we're going to get you guys all to come along with your best questions, right? And you'll know exactly what to ask, right? Because we've been talking about all this stuff. So anyway, listen, let's get into the meat of today's session, which is microtones in the blues. And we first have to answer a question, which is, what on earth are microtones? Well, I mean, I guess I should ask you guys in the comment section, right? So if anybody has a good definition for microtones, drop it in the comments down below, because I'd love to hear it. If you know what microtones are, I'd love to hear from you. But I'll be giving you my definition as we go on, which I think is a pretty reasonable definition. So the first thing we have to establish, let's go to the close-up cam for this, is what the 12 notes that we're dealing with in Western music are. These are notes that are not microtones. This is what we generally refer to as the 12 notes in a 12-tone even temperament system. Wow, what's that going to do with the blues? Well, what it basically means is we know that Chris Brown's got a really succinct definition. We'll get to that in a second. Basically, we divide our musical octave, which is the distance between, say, this E and this E. We could do Cs like other instruments, but we're going to do Es because we're guitar players. And we know that in the distance, we have, in the distance between those, we have 12 notes that we can play. We have E, we have an F, F sharp, G, G sharp, A, B, flat or A sharp, B, C, C sharp, D, and D sharp or E flat. You can refer to the sharps and flats however you want. It depends upon the context of the key, but I mean, that's something we'll maybe talk about another time. Now, we tend to think about each one of these notes as being the things that we play, and there's nothing to be found in between them. But in actual fact, if we just take a quick second, let's do a quick experiment here, right? So very quickly, I want you to play, sorry, pardon me, I have to cough quite a lot today. I want you to play the following with me. If we take the 10th fret on the B string, and then we try playing the 10th fret against the 12th fret on the B string. Let's play 10, then 12. We'll go again, 10, 12. Pretty simple stuff. Now, in between those, if we just fret these notes, we have one possible note that exists in between those notes. It's the 11th fret. And if we were playing a piano, that would be all that would be available to us, because the piano is restricted by the individual keys that you play. You play a key, it strikes a series of strings, it produces that note. You can't influence that note without getting your hands inside the piano and doing some weird stuff, so we're not going to do that. However, we as guitar players can play this 10-12 business like this. So let's try that. Let's try playing 10 and then bend it up to the pitch of 12. Now in there, in that gap, we have a theoretically infinite number of notes. And by theoretically infinite, I mean we can basically play, I mean, it's like the conundrum Zeno's paradox is what it is. The conundrum of firing an arrow at a tortoise, which is something we'll maybe talk about another time. We're not here to talk philosophy. We're here to talk about guitar. But basically, in between this note and this note, if we bend, we can find an infinite number of notes because we can continue dividing it forever. We could play this note, this note, this note, this note, this note, this note, this note. Are those all notes? I think the answer is yes. Now, they're not all notes that we can necessarily give names to. We can pull up to the main cam for this. This is because I feel like I'm done with that bit now for the time being. James is operating the cameras for me today because I can't reach. It's all the way over there. So yeah, we have James behind the camera, which is why I look in focus for the first time today. So I'm sorry, James.
Just check the mic.
Oh, I think we're getting a little bit of a microphone issue. Quite roomy. Let me check that it's plugged in. How's that for you, James? Is that a little bit better? How's that for you? We getting it? Yeah. Yeah, we'll have to wait and find out. We'll figure that out. So, anyway, so we generally wouldn't give these notes that exist in between these frets, we wouldn't give them names in the Western sense, in that we wouldn't call them like B flat 0.2. I'm gonna, but we generally wouldn't. But that doesn't mean that they're not notes. If we can play it, it's a note. right? It's basic top and bottom of it. So we've got some cool definitions here. We've got some really good ones. Chris Brown says the notes in between the semitones. For sure, that's a really, really good definition. Sacred God Slayer says microtones are wavelengths Westerners are not used to. I will kind of beg to differ on this one, because there are some microtones that Westerners are very used to, but some of them there aren't. We'll get to that. Quarter tone bends, no idea what a microtone is. Well, quarter tone bends are one of the ways we tend to refer to microtones in the context of a blues, and we're going to get to that. PJ says, in between the half tones, sure, tones outside Western music, certainly tones outside of Western European classical music, that's for sure. But the blues is outside of that too. Who else do we have? Phil Jones says, very good definition here, not an integer multiple of a semitone, I guess, for sure. Krakatom says, the end of the smoke on the water solo. Oh, for sure, that fantastic bit where he's going, really good. Like, that's a really great example, because how many notes are in there, right? If you tried to tap that out in Guitar Pro, best of luck, because it wants this one, and this one, but there's not. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 individual notes in between there, going from D to C. Pretty cool. Now, how does this shake out for us as blues players? Well, first of all, we need to answer the question of the minor pentatonic and its relationship to the blues. Now, we are often told that the minor pentatonic is the core of blues. It is, in a sense, in that it's the closest thing we can map to the actual sound of the scale that blues singers will use when they sing. What do I mean by that? Well, let's go to the close-up cam and let me show you what I'm talking about. So I'm going to play my slow blues. And the first thing I do is I'm going to play a minor pentatonic scale, which will go like this. We're in B, so we're going to get the following. We'll get 10, 7, 10, 7, 9, 7, 9, 7, 9, 7, 10, 7, right? Simple as that. I'm going to play this. And then I'm going to play it with some adjustments. So take a listen to this, right? Here it is on its own. Here it is with adjustments. I'll let it come back to the next chord. With the adjustments, check it out. So we go. Let me do it again. Now, immediately, with some of those little adjustments and those little tweaks, the bends, that's how we got them, we immediately found ourselves with a more interesting and more soulful sound, and I'm going to show you how to get this and how to line this up and how it all kind of comes together. My niece here says Ace Frehley does those bend things, does the things a lot too, or did in the 70s. Bend pitch and pick like five times you release the bend. For sure, it's really great. Now, singers do this as well. Here's the thing. There's a really great video where someone auto-tuned, I think it was Rick Beato, I think he auto-tuned, or it might be Adam Neely, auto-tuned Robert Plant, and it became worse. Even though it was in tune, it's in tune to a piano keyboard, it became worse. Why? Because there is magic in between those semitones. There are wonderful notes that sound more in tune than they do. They sound more in tune than the in tune notes do, if that makes sense. It was Adam Neely, says Sacred God Slayer. Sure, we made it worse. Same as when we timeline John Bonham, we made it worse. So this is the same thing, but with pitch. Now, let's do a quick experiment on this. What I want you guys to do is we're going to limit ourselves with some blues soloing. We're going to go back to the close-up cam real quick. And let's limit ourselves to two notes. Now, our two notes are going to be the tonic, which is this B note, and the minor third, which will be this D note. Now, with just these two here, let's see if we can conjure ourselves some solos, right? No bends yet. And what we might end up with is something that sounds thoroughly amateurish, but that's okay, because we're going to turn it into something really cool in just a second. Now, grab your guitars, because we're going to do this together. I'm going to leave you some space to play. Let's try going like this. Take a turn.
I see.
222. We're having some microphone issues, so we're going to get rid of that. We're going to clip it on. That's James. There we go. Much better. Okay, let's try that again. Now that we do a pass on this, right, we're going to go one more time. But this time what I'm going to encourage you to do is I'm going to encourage you to play this D note, but I'm going to encourage you to bend it just a teeny tiny bit. So not as far as this pitch, maybe about here. Notice how immediately you take a turn. Notice how immediately it sounds better. Isn't that crazy? Well, we'll get into why in just a second, but let me do a quick comparison for you. I'll go between the two. And we'll talk about some more situational examples here. So, real quick, let's just go back to this one more time. So, very quickly, I'm going to play the unadjusted pitches. So no bends, we're going to go here. With some adjustments. Going on here. Let me explain it to you. So let's come out to the main cam. Hopefully you guys can hear this dialogue a little bit better now. I've clipped this onto my my collar. James was giving me some fantastic semaphore going like, put it, I don't know, I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about, man. But he's a good hand. He knows what's going on. He's got solutions to all the problems, and I have ways to confound all of James's clever solutions like I did just there. Let me explain what's going on here. So first of all, this microtonal bend is one that we're all familiar with, right? It's the little quarter tone bend that we do in a blues, right? Well, when I say quarter tone, there is more nuance to it than that we're going to get into in a second. But what's basically happening here is what we want to hear on this particular note, if we were to sing this to ourselves, we wouldn't sing this interval. We wouldn't sing this interval. We would sing something in between, which might be something like that. Now that's an interesting thing in and of itself, right? Because that's the kind of interval that singers will tend to produce. We would refer to this as a blue third, or a third that is in between the major and the minor thirds. Now, interestingly, you hear variations on this depending upon whether you want to hear this as more of a major third or more minor third, and we'll get into why in a second. But generally speaking, over the one chord in a major blues, like we're playing here, or over a dominant blues, we want to hear this as closer to this fret than to this fret. So we're going to give it a little more of a bend. So don't think about it as a quarter, think about this as maybe 0.75. So instead of halfway to here, maybe 0.75 of the way to there. And think about that line, put on your high heel sneakers. That sounds like the blues. If we play it like this, it sounds different, but it's not the same as this. That sounds like the Doors. There's nothing wrong with that, that's cool, but this. That sounds like the sound we're trying to make. Now, this changes over a minor blues and also changes over the four chord, because over the four chord, this is no longer the third. So if we play off our one chord, B, that becomes the major third, or something resembling the major third. Over our four chord, which is E, this D note is now the seventh. And what we want to hear on our seventh is maybe about a quarter of the way up. So it's not a full halfway between here and here. It's a tiny bit. So here's how we're going to experiment with this. Over the one chord, we're going to bend this. Think about that as a full semitone bend. We're going to bend this about three quarters of a semitone. And then over the four chord, we're going to bend it about a quarter of a semitone, a tiny bit. Not leave it all the way flat, but just a teeny tiny bend. Listen to this, right? Listen to the difference this makes. Now, make sure we get over the four chords. Over the one chord, a little bit more sharp. We're going to leave it be over the five chords. A little flatter over the four chord, a little sharper over the one chord. Let me take this a step further by giving you a one note solo. That's quite enough of that one note business, but what you can hear there, if your ears are attuned to this sort of stuff, right? Which this should be, because you're all smart guitar players. We have an unbelievably well-educated guitar audience. It's really great to see. So what you'll notice with this is over this chord, over this one chord, that slightly sharper bend sounds fantastic. And then over the four chord, that slightly flatter bend sounds absolutely fantastic. Let's extrapolate this out to other places in our minor pentatonic scale. Let's examine every one of the notes and see what we are to do with them to make them sound cool. So let's go to the close-up camera. Let's start with the one chord as our example. So this is our minor pentatonic scale. Over the one chord, we're going to take all of the thirds and move them up by about two-thirds of a semitone. So that's here. Here. And here. Does that make sense? We're going to take all of our sevens, which are here, and here, and move those up by literally the tiniest amount. So it's not here, it's here. Again, not here, but here. That's over the one chord. So our one chord minor pentatonic might sound like this. Four chord, we change it slightly. We take what was our third, and we don't bend it as far. We leave this note alone. We give this a little bend, and leave all the other notes be. So once again, those are the differences. A quick reminder, one chords, bend the thirds most of the way, bend the sevenths a tiny bit. Over the four chord, in minor pentatonic, bend those thirds a tiny bit, don't bend any of the others just yet. We're going to get to that. And let's see how that scans out over the course of a 12 bar. And then I'll give you guys a chance to play with this. Just for reference, let's do the same thing, more minor pentatonic, no bends. Let's go back to the close-up camera. Suddenly it doesn't sound so good. Snuck one in there by accident. Hard to not do them. Let's bring those bends in. Suddenly we're doing something, right? Can you hear what a difference that makes? Hear what a difference that makes? Do it with no color at all, Nick. It's a long blues, but I'll try. Let's try. Here we go. No color at all. Okay. Sounds like notes. Doesn't sound bad. But it doesn't really sound like blues. Somebody's tuning in right at this minute. This is an example of how not to do it. So let's do it one more time with the collar. Now I'm going to give you guys a turn. So let's start with the one chord. Remember, you bend up your thirds a good amount. Bend at the sevenths, not so much. Next up, let's go to the four chord, bend the thirds a little bit, leave the sevenths alone. Notice how the whole demeanor of the scale has sunk down and become more mean and more somber. Let's bring it back up, so bend the thirds a little more over the one chord, bend the sevenths a tiny bit. Very nice. Notice that big lift going on there. Now, if you really want to catch the energy of that five chord, just bend the seventh quite a lot. Watch this. Literally. literally the same two frets, but we played over all of those changes, right? So now, here we go. Christopher Brown says, I've definitely heard that at jam nights. I've definitely played that at jam nights too, let me tell you. It's like the Expressive Techniques promo. It really is. I'm going to show you the promo in a second. I've got to tell you, like, I don't want to be a dick. But those bits where I go, hey, does your playing sound like this? They are the hardest bits to film because this stuff's just baked in there now. But it's one of those. Really great comment from our man Jonathan Graham says, expression greater than no choice. For sure. 100%. But, I mean, I guess I would file this under no choice to an extent because it's not so much... It is what you do with the note, but it's which of the endless variations of that note you choose from. A little anecdote before we move on from this is there's a really great thing from AC/DC's Highway to Hell album where I think something, I don't know if I've got the numbers quite right, but I think there are 7 songs in the key of A, but all of them are different A's. Because they all just tune to Angus. And like he would tune his guitar by ear and go, yep, lads, that's A, let's go. So... Seven different A's on Highway to Hell, and they all sound pretty great. But yeah, that's an example of this stuff. I'm going to leave you with one more little thought before we move on to the question and answer session. Fun little thing we can do with this is we can do a little treatment on the 5. And the 5 works really, really well over our 1 chord. And this works over the... jeez, John. A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A-A- No, I'm joking. Yeah. What was I saying? Oh, yeah, the five. Okay, so this is a fun thing that you can do over any five of any of the chords. So if you're playing the five over the... let's go to the close-up count for this. If you're playing the five over one chord, it would be this fifth note. If you're playing the five over the four chord, it would be the B note. It would be the equivalent of the one. And then again, playing over this chord, it would be that C-sharp note. What we can do with this is we can approach it from a semitone below, so we can get this. So instead of playing this five here, we can approach from a semitone below and just not quite get there. So this sounds loads better than this. Good fun. Now that's one of the reasons why Brian May sounds so sweet. We're not talking about Brian May, but when he does that lovely Lydian thing that he'll do where he'll go it's always just the tiniest hint flat, and that's why it sounds so really lovely, right? Really lovely. I'm doing a sponsored pun day. A sponsored no pun day at work. Oh no. We've got questions coming in already. If you have questions, drop them down below. I'm just going to show you some stuff with this five, and then we'll take a brief break to let you get your questions in, and then on we go. Okay, check it out. Let's hit those flatted fives. Greg Cock there for a second. So there you go, guys. That has been a brief look at Overtones and the Blues. When we come back, we're going to answer your questions. Your questions. Get them in, otherwise it'll all be Jonathan's questions, which are good questions. He is interviewer par excellence. So John's got good questions. If you want them answered, if you want questions, drop me in. In the meantime, check this out. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. It'll help with this sort of stuff. You can get it as part of your GI Plus membership. Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this. Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques, and we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff, and I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared, and I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So there you go, guys. That's a look at one of the courses that you get as part of your GI Plus membership. That's Expressive Techniques. I think it's a really, really good one, personally, right? But I would say that because I made it. A reminder, you've just joined us, right? You've just joined us, or you've joined us at some point in the last 30 minutes. I didn't want to kind of like stop the lesson to bring this through, but I want to remind you, next week's stream, very special one. We have a guest, and our special guest is Josh Smith, like that Josh Smith. Guitar Zan Josh Smith. The very same. He's going to be on the stream, and we're going to be talking about blues playing. Well, talking about all kinds of playing, really. If you have questions for Josh, make sure you're there next week, right? Drop them in the comments. I'll be fielding them to him. So I'll be sending Josh as many questions as we possibly can, right? We'll be making the most of our time together. We've got an hour. It's going to be great. So make sure you're there next week. Make sure you've got questions for Josh. Hopefully this is the beginning of several, a recurring infrequent but recurring series of guest streams, because I would love to have some of my favorite players on, and Josh is absolutely one of them. So great comments, great questions. First of all, Cranky Tom, as it all sounds a bit like Jeff Beck on his telly, making you think it has a whammy bar. Sure, right? These in-between notes are something that that Jeff Beck did just par excellence, right? And it's why he sounded so much like a singer. Now, if you've ever heard somebody say, oh, you really made that guitar sing, I think that's kind of what they're talking about to an extent. It means you made that guitar sound like a singer. It sounded like something that resonated with me on a human level, and that's normally a voice. And, you know, that's the deal. That's why I like Chris Buck so much. I mean, Jonathan and I have been talking about Chris Buck an awful lot after he got back from the Keeping the Blues Alive at Sea cruise. Outrageous. And Chris is so good at this stuff too. So anyway, right, some great comments. Just going to highlight some of these. First of all, Chris Brown. There's Greg Koch and Josh Smith are the dream team, maybe with Eric Gales. Man, what a trio. I would pay good money to see that, let me tell you. But we love a bit of that. So Sacred Godslayer, great comments. Says, one spends years to learn to do all of his bendings in tune just to throw it all in the bin. Well, I mean, I guess the takeaway from this is that tuning is a lie. It's not true. Tuning is contextual. So it depends on the kind of music you're playing. There are times when being absolutely in tune is the thing. One of my favorite examples of when this goes wrong is... Have a listen to the John Mayer guitar solo. Don't just throw John Mayer under the bus. John Mayer is a wonderful guitar player. But have a listen to the John Mayer guitar solo on the Fall Out Boy version of Beat It, right? And I'll tell you why. It's because contextually, it's a style of music that thrives on being super tuned. This is not the Michael Jackson Beat It, it's the Fall Out Boy cover, right? It's so tuned. It's just tuned beyond belief, right? All the guitars are perfectly in tune. All the vocals are perfectly in tune. To a 12-tone even temperament, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. It sounds great for it. And then John Mayer comes in and lays down the big blues. And it just sounds weird. It just sounds grating. But then you listen to the same stuff in John's own music. It's gorgeous. It's absolutely beautiful. It's the same reason why, you know, there's a video doing the rounds right now. And again, I don't want to throw guitar players under the bus. Because I think the guys from... we'll talk about the guys from Polyphia, for example. The guys from Polyphia... Fabulous guitar players, the pair of them. But there's a video of them jamming with Steve Vai, and it's just not great. And I think the reason for it is the kind of intervals that these guys thrive on, which are these very in-tune intervals, very 12-tone intervals, don't really fly over that live blues jam kind of context. And it's why it just sounds a bit off, even though they're playing the right notes. And you can see the confusion, bless them, on, you know, the faces of these maestros, these fabulous young guitar players who play things I could only dream of getting my fingers around. You can see them going, wait a minute, that should have worked. Why didn't it work? I think this is part of it. I think there's something to do with it. So it's contextual is what I'm saying with this, is your tuning is contextual. So a couple of questions coming in. Here's a good one from a friend, Jonathan. Jonathan Graham says, thoughts on pick versus fingers with the micro bends. Important dynamic difference. I don't think it makes a difference in terms of the bend, particularly. I know that's not what you're saying, but just in case anybody is confused by what's being said here, I don't think it makes a difference to making the bend more in tune or any of that stuff or any of that kind of business. But I think fingers can be really interesting for creating certain vowel sounds that interact with the bend in a certain way. So if I play with my pick, for example, I'm not going to say I'm limited in terms of the vowels I can make, but I can make a sound that sounds a bit like this. Or like this, or like this, or like this. With my fingers, I can play this, or I can play this, or I can play this, or anywhere in between. So it gives, even though the bend is the same, it gives me a wider variety of colors to hang on that bend, which is kind of interesting. So here's another one from Cowcat. There's an old guitar player interview. Satriani talks about how he studied B.B. King's bends on minor blues, depending upon the interval used, just like the lesson today. You know, BB was the man, right? And Satch is the man too. That's one of the reasons why Satch sounds so... I actually, you know what it is? I'm going to go out on a limb here, and I'm going to say this is one of the reasons why people who aren't into shred are still into Joe Satriani. They go, well, I like Satch. And I think people will attribute it to, oh, well, there's more melody there. Don't think it is. I think there's that human blues voice there that maybe isn't there in some other players. And I think the same is true for Scott Henderson in the fusion world. It's why a lot of blues players can get on with Scott when maybe they don't get on so well with someone like, you know, like John Scofield, for example. I don't know, just pulling names out of the air here. Chris Brown's great question says, Nick, who is your number one blues player, past or present? That is a humongous question that I don't think I can answer. Where to begin? There are so many. I think I'm going to have to think about that. There are too many. I can't narrow it down. So I'll just say Chris Buck, because Chris is our boy. beg pardon. So, Chris, my mailing address is in the doobly-doo. Anyway, so some other cool questions have come in, some of the cool comments. Just going to highlight some of these very, very, very quickly. Let's just get some of this. Eddie's solo was out slightly. It was, but it wasn't in such a tuned environment, if that makes sense. So the Michael Jackson one wasn't as heavily tuned as Fall Out Boy is, for example. Not an issue. We're caught in controversy here. But again, this is no slur on any of these guitar players. It's contextual. It's 100% contextual, right? 100% contextual. Who else do we have? Vi was very encouraging, though. Vi was. Somebody actually posted a really cool thought on this, where they said it was a little like watching Vi's early improvisations with Zappa. Where Vi was the same thing, where he's going, well, this should sound great, and why doesn't it? And you had Frank there acting as the elder statesman and kind of encouraging him along. And there was a parallel there, maybe. This is not to take away from the guys in Polyphia. They are outrageous guitar players, just phenomenal. Like, you know, I can't do what they do. Couldn't hope to. But, you know, it's not me being old man yells at cloud. It's just context, you know? Neither is better or worse or good nor bad. It's all contextual. So anyway, we got a few more real quick. Fingers on the subject, fingers versus pick. Fingers rounds out the note that's gonna be edgily out of context. Very interesting, that's a fair point, very fair point. Here's another one, real quick. It was a bass player friend that pointed out to Chris that the solo was slightly out of tune, for sure. We got a lot of love for Joe Bonamassa, for the greatest living blues player. You know, I think there is an argument for Joe being the greatest modern era blues player. Now, you can say this without really considering his playing. It's not about who's the best player. It's not what we're talking about here. But in terms of being an ambassador for the blues and bringing the blues to the masses, I don't think you can argue that it's Joe. Personally, I mean, if not Joe, then who? I mean, geez, you've really got me thinking about this whole business of best, my favorite blues guitar player. That's the best question. Favorite is better than best. We like flavor. We like favorite. Also, Joe is the cover artist for the October issue. So yeah, keep your eyes peeled. New issue of Guitar Interactive magazine incoming October with Joe on the cover. So listen, guys, thank you so much for having me. I'm going to cough once again. Beg your pardon. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI+. This all but one concludes our series of streams on the subject of the blues. We have another subject of streams coming away on the 18th. But before we do that, we have one more great stream. Don't forget, it's next week, same place, 8 p.m. UK time, this channel, wherever you're watching it. We got Josh Smith. We're going to be asking him questions. He's going to be answering questions. It's going to be fantastic. I will see you guys next week. In the meantime, let's play a bit more blues, this time a minor blues. And I'm going to show you a little bit about how this might work. A very quick lesson, because minor blues are cool too. Minor blues, real simple. Just don't bend the third as much. But still do it. There's a really fun. Really fun one for the four chord. That works a treat too. We're going to be in C. Keep your eyes peeled. This is how it works in the minor blues. We'll be right back. it's fun to be had. And of course, don't forget all that cool stuff we talked about funny sounding scales, melodic minors and all that, that still applies. In the meantime, thanks for having us. My name is Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Don't forget, go to guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus URL down below to get all of this. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.